It was the dawn of a new century, and although the British Empire was not yet an empire where the sun never sets, it did have colonial possessions that were scattered all over the world. By 1805, the British East India Company directly controlled the eastern coast of India. To secure the sea route to India, the British wanted to establish a presence in the Persian/Arabian Gulf, accusing the Al-Qasimi dynasty, the main maritime power in the Persian/Arabian Gulf, of piracy. The British launched two punitive expeditions to the region, one in 1809 and another in 1819. Then, in 1820, the Emirates of Abu Dhabi, Sharjah, Ajman, Umm Al Quwain, and Ras Al Khaimah signed a treaty with the British, which ended piracy and aligned them closer to the British. The Emirates also had to replace their existing flags with new flags. Another treaty was signed in 1853, which imposed an informal British protectorate over the Emirates called the Trucial States. This was succeeded by the 1892 Exclusive Agreement, which prevented the Trucial States from establishing relations with other countries without British consent. The Trucial States were economically tied closer to British India, exporting pearls to the colony. Furthermore, the Indian rupee also became the currency of the region. Although these three treaties isolated the Trucial States from the rest of the world, they were a stabilizing force and a safeguard against threats. Then, after the Second World War, the relationship between the British and the Trucial States underwent a transformation. With India's independence in 1947, the British were no longer interested in protecting the route to India. However, they were still interested in maintaining their presence in the Persian/Arabian Gulf to secure their access to oil that was discovered in the region. In the 1950s and 1960s, the Trucial States underwent through a period of a rapid modernization. The best example of this was the Emirate of Dubai, which grew into a commercial hub under the leadership of Sheikh Rashid bin Zayed Al Maktoum. This economic growth attracted many immigrants, especially from South Asia. When oil was discovered in the Emirate in 1966, it was cautious to base its economy on oil, fearing that oil would run out in a few generations. This caution was best highlighted by a quote widely attributed to Sheikh Rashid. "My grandfather rode a camel. My father rode a camel. I drive a Mercedes. My son drives a Land Rover. His son will drive a Land Rover, but his son will ride a camel." Things were far different in the neighboring Emirate of Abu Dhabi. Abu Dhabi was not on the path of rapid modernization, as the Emirate's ruler, Sheikh Shahbud bin Sultan Al Nahyan, was hesitant to use the oil revenue to develop the Emirate. This led to him being replaced with his brother, Sheikh Zayed bin Sultan Al Nahyan, in 1966. Sheikh Zayed was a believer in modernization, and immediately after becoming the ruler, he used the Emirates' vast oil revenue to finance his program of vigorous development. This led to a rapid improvement in Abu Dhabi's economic conditions. Sheikh Zayed also financially contributed to the development of other less prosperous Emirates. However, the rapid modernization and growth of the Trucial States also attracted gold traffickers from India, which was depleting the country's foreign cash reserves. The Indian government responded by creating the Gulf rupee, replacing the Indian rupee as the currency of the region. 7 years later, though, the Gulf rupee was devalued against the Indian rupee. The Emirates in the region then abandoned the currency in favor of other currencies, leading to the region no longer being monetarily tied to India. On the 16th of January 1968, British Prime Minister Harold Wilson announced that all British troops would withdraw from the east of the Suez by the end of 1971. The British faced economic hardship at home and thus couldn't maintain a presence in the Gulf. This announcement dismayed the rulers of the Emirates, as they felt the British would remain in the region to protect their strategic interests. Abu Dhabi Sheikh Zayed unsuccessfully offered to pay for British military presence in the region. The withdrawal caused the Emirates to fear for the future, as the strategic location could attract foreign powers who would occupy and dominate them. Their withdrawal was viewed by Iran as a golden opportunity to establish their dominance over the region. Saudi Arabia viewed the withdrawal as both a concern and an opportunity to settle its territorial disputes with Abu Dhabi in its favor. The Emirates were also threatened by the Marxist and Arab Nationalist Popular Front for the Liberation of the Occupied Arabian Gulf, or PFLOAG, whose stated goal was the overthrow of all monarchies in the region. To protect the sovereignty of the Emirates, the idea of a federation began to emerge. Prior to the speech of Prime Minister Wilson in January 1968, there were attempts to unite and strengthen ties between the Emirates. The first idea of a union, comprising the Trucial states Qatar, Bahrain and Kuwait, was first proposed in 1937. The creation of the Trucial States Council in 1952 further strengthened the concept of unity among the seven Emirates of the Trucial States. The Development Office and the Development Fund were established in 1965 in order to coordinate development projects across the seven Emirates. However, the first real step towards a federal union was only taken in February 1968 when Abu Dhabi Sheikh Zayed paid a visit to Dubai Sheikh Rashid. An agreement was reached which resolved disputes between the two Emirates and established a union between the two. The two Emirates then invited the rest of the Trucial states and the two neighboring Emirates of Qatar and Bahrain to form a federation. In the same month, the nine Emirates agreed to form a federal union called the Federation of Arab Emirates. The federal union would establish ties between the Emirates in all fields, such as foreign policy, economics, politics, and defense. They would also coordinate their plans for development. But the initial optimism around the nine-member federal union soon evaporated. There were many points of contention between the nine Emirates, such as on the composition of the federal council, on the contribution made by each Emirate to the federal budget, and on the formation of a united defense force. Throughout the negotiations, the rivalry between Bahrain and Qatar over the leadership of the union also became clear. Bahrain was the most populated emirate in the proposed union, while Qatar had a level of development higher than the rest of the emirates. Consequently, Qatar and Bahrain withdrew from the proposed nine-member union. In spite of the withdrawal, the rest of the Emirates continued to work towards a union, albeit a seven-member federal union. Due to the Trucial States Council, the seven Emirates were politically closer to each other than they were to Qatar or Bahrain. Abu Dhabi was to lead the new federal union, as it was the largest by area, richest and the largest oil-producing emirate in the Trucial States. However, issues regarding the capital and the government structure emerged between the Emirates, which were resolved by July of 1971. The city of Abu Dhabi was to be the interim capital, with a permanent capital to be built on the border of Abu Dhabi and Dubai, called Al Karamah. The country's highest constitutional body, possessing both executive and legislative powers, the Federal Supreme Council, was to be made up of the rulers of the seven emirates. Regarding the voting procedure, for any resolution to be passed by the Supreme Council, it required the approval of at least five emirates, including that of Abu Dhabi and Dubai. The total number of representatives in the Federal National Council, a consultative quasi-legislative body, was to be fixed at 40, with the Emirates being represented unequally. But the Emirate of Ras Al Khaimah voiced opposition against the voting procedure of the Federal Supreme Council and their representation at the Federal National Council. The rest of the Emirates then officially formed a union, leaving Ras Al Khaimah out of it. In August, Bahrain declared its independence, and the following month, Qatar also declared its independence. Although it no longer claimed the island of Bahrain, Iran still claimed the islands of Abu Musa and the Greater and Lesser Tombs, and on the 30th of November, seized them. Nevertheless, on the second day of December 1971, the six emirates of Abu Dhabi, Dubai, Sharjah, Ajman, Umm Al Quwain and Fujairah formed an independent federal union called the United Arab Emirates. The country's new president and vice president were Sheikh Zayed bin Sultan Al Nahyan and Sheikh Rashid bin Zayed Al Maktoum respectively. Few months later, Ras Al Khaimah also joined the federation. Although the Emirates surrendered some of their powers to the federal government, they still maintained substantial autonomy in their affairs. In 1973, the seven Emirates abandoned their separate currencies in favor of the dirham as the country's official currency. 3 years later, a united armed forces was established. In 1974, Sheikh Zayed and Saudi Arabia's King Faisal signed the Treaty of Jeddah, which stipulated that UAE had to cede land in exchange for Saudi recognition of the union. This brought an end to fears of Saudi Arabia threatening the sovereignty of the union. Iran's plan to replace the United Kingdom as the dominant power in the Persian/Arabian Gulf also never materialized, and in 1971, the Shah was overthrown in a revolution. By 1976, the PFLOAG was suppressed and no longer posed a threat to the UAE. Out of all the attempted Arab unions in history, only three have succeeded, and the United Arab Emirates is one of them. So what were the main reasons for the success of the formation of the United Arab Emirates? I would argue that there were four main factors for the union's success. First and foremost, the union was a necessity if the Emirates wanted to preserve the sovereignty. The possibility of Iranian domination, Saudi claims on Abu Dhabi's territory, and the resurgence of the PFLOAG would have placed the sovereignty of the seven Emirates at risk. The only option for the Emirates, especially for the five poorer ones, was the formation of a federal union that would safeguard them from these threats. However, fear wasn't enough to bring the rulers of the seven Emirates together. Close cultural and political ties were also a factor in the formation of the union. The seven Emirates share a similar culture, with a similar dialect, cuisine, and clothing. But this is also shared with other Arab countries of the Persian/Arabian Gulf, especially with Qatar and Bahrain. So why did the proposed nine-member union fail? Although cultural similarity was a factor, political ties were also essential for the success of the union. The seven Emirates were interdependent on each other and had a history of cooperation. The Trucial States Council, along with the Development Office and the Development Fund, were established to facilitate cooperation between the Emirates, especially regarding their development and modernization program. These institutions never existed between Qatar, Bahrain, and the Trucial States. The Emirates of the Trucial States were also more willing to accept Abu Dhabi's leadership, as Sheikh Zayed was known for his generosity and financial support for the five poorer Emirates. While the aforementioned two reasons were important, it is to be mentioned that the British also played a role in the establishment of the Union. First and foremost, the British were the main force behind the formation of the Trucial States Council, the Development Office, and the Development Fund. They also supported the nine-member union plan and tried to prevent it from collapsing. Without the institutions that they established and the support they provided, it would have been harder to achieve a union. Undoubtedly, the role of Sheikh Zayed in the formation of the Union also shouldn't be forgotten. Spending his youth among the Bedouins in the desert, he learned their ways and traditions. He also learned the Bedouin method of resolving conflicts through consensus and compromise, while maintaining a sense of brotherhood. Sheikh Zayed was influenced by their method of conflict resolution and employed it throughout his life. Prior to the 1968 speech of Harold Wilson, Abu Dhabi financially aided the development of other less fortunate emirates. Sheikh Zayed also first approached Dubai's Sheikh Rashid to form a union between the two emirates in 1968, which was the first step towards the formation of the UAE. He also urged the rulers of the emirates to cooperate with each other and to work in common interest. Employing the Bedouin method of conflict resolution, Sheikh Zayed often made compromises and urged others to make compromises, along with striving to maintain a sense of unity among the Emirates. The three pillars of Bedouin conflict resolution, which Sheikh Zayed utilized, were essential to the formation of the United Arab Emirates. Therefore, he is regarded by many Emiratis as the father of the nation. It is for these four factors that the United Arab Emirates is a success story among a sea of failed Arab unions. After independence, the UAE went on a path of rapid development, which was propelled by the country's vast oil revenue. 50 years later, the United Arab Emirates is a major economic and military power in West Asia, wielding substantial influence in the region and beyond.